Now, what I want to get to, Dell, is the same process that made the folds and bends here were working in Grand Canyon. The same time that this area was uplifted, the Grand Canyon area was uplifted, and we get the monocline and so forth in Grand Canyon. And I want to explain to you what a monocline is and how that forms.
All right.
Now let's first of all go to this picture right here, and then I want to simplify this a bit for you. This area right in here is called the East Kaibab Monocline, and I'll explain to you over on the whiteboard what this is, but notice there's a fault right in here, and I'll show you what a fault is, and then there's a bend or a fold in the rocks.
Okay. All right.
Okay, so let me explain this to you. So, Delt, when you have a fault, you have an actual break in the rocks, and so you can see that layer that I've colored in there.
Yeah. Right.
It moves and we get a break in the rocks. That's what's called a fault. When you get a fold, the rocks don't break. A fold is when the rocks are like this. And so this is what happened in the Grand Canyon, and maybe the two of us can work on this together here. I can hold those blocks up like this so we get a fault.
So the fault has occurred.
Yep. But we get the layers on top that are bending kind of like that.
And the difference is because these are solid?
The rocks on the bottom are brittle. The rocks on the top are softer or haven't hardened all the way yet.
Yeah.
We do get a little bit of faulting in the rocks on top, but not anything like the rocks down in what we call the basement. Those rocks are hard and brittle. And if we look back on our map, you can actually see there's quite a bit of offset on some of those rocks in the basement.
Well, those faults have caused a lot of movement, a lot of movement.
And as some of that movement took place, it caused the bending in the rocks on top. Now, that's what's called a monocline. Let me sketch all this on the board. It's kind of a complicated process to understand. Here's our here's what would be a fault. Right in here like this, and I've put some arrows on there to show the faulting. And what we have is the rocks that are on top more or less drape themselves right over that fault. Okay? And so we do have a little bit of faulting here and there in these rocks, but not quite as much down in the basement. And because these rocks are soft, they bend and fold quite a bit. And this layer that's right here on the bottom, this is the Tapetes sandstone. And this is one of the layers that we can trace all the way across the North American continent. In fact, we find rock very similar to this in places like Israel and throughout Europe and so on. And it's really a layer that we think was made worldwide, which would be a flood layer. And these rocks are folded and bent all the way up through Paleozoic, which we think are flood rocks, Mesozoic, which we think are flood rocks. And then the rocks above the Mesozoic are nice and flat or largely aren't affected by this folding process. So again, we think that's an indication that the flood is over, that the flood has ended.
Those happened after, though.
That's right.
Yeah. So if these had been hard and brittle, like these, then what we would see here is a continuation of the fault line, and these layers simply drop down.
Yeah, let me draw that for you. If these layers were hard and brittle, we would not have this fold in here, and instead the fault would go up to there.
Yeah.
And we'd see something like that.
Right.
Where the Tapetes would be here, and the Tapetes would be up there.
And this is what one would expect if all of these layers followed the geological timetable. Extremely old.
That's right.
Extremely brittle. And when they fell or rose, I don't know which way here, then it would have broken, just like we see in earthquakes today where, you know, you see the rocks break.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And so, you know, the point is that the faulting that takes place here in a conventional time frame happens in the neighborhood of about 50 million years ago. this would be from a conventional view, and MA stands for millions of years there. That the peat sandstone was made about 530 MA or so, millions of years ago. And so you can see there's almost 500 million years of difference between yes. those two events. And so in a conventional time frame, this is exactly what we would expect. We would expect this picture instead of the monocline that we see.
Correct.
Because we have the monocline, we think that the faulting event and the Tapetes were not very distant from each other.
Mm-hmm.
And so we think the Tapetes was laid down early in the flood. We think the faulting happened right at the end of the flood. And that is why we have the bending that takes place.
And the same would be true for each of the layers in that folding.
That's right. They go all the way up through.
Because they're still soft.
That's right.
That they folded rather than broke.
So this monocline, we see this in Grand Canyon in Arizona. But as we go north into Utah, we see the same thing in a place we call the Coxcomb. And beyond that, the rocks are folded spectacularly up that way.
Yeah.
So this is the detailed cross-section of the East Kaibab monocline.
Okay.
And you can see the monocline right in here, how the folding has happened. There are several faults in here. Not all of these faults happened right at the end of the flood. There's probably some movement earlier on. But the main movement that caused the folding right here, that caused the monocline, happened right at the end of the flood as the whole Colorado Plateau and the Rocky Mountain region was lifted up.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what caused the bending right there. And so let's talk of the sequence of events. We have some of these lower layers of rock were made before the flood even started, some of them even at the creation week. We have flood sediments that were laid down. So this package of sediments here, and you can follow the right above the green and up higher in the blue up there at the top.
Mm-hmm.
Those sediments were laid down during the flood. Here is the Tapetes. You can see the Tapetes
yes.
layer over there.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So that layer goes across North America. So that's one of the first flood
yes.
layers that was laid down. And then we have these other layers laid down during the flood. And even more than what's shown on this cross section was laid down during the flood.
More layers above
yeah.
above here.
So we can go up into Utah and see other layers that were made in the flood as well. But as the flood comes to an end, and as the continents are picked up, we have some more
mm-hmm.
faulting here. And because these rocks were hard, they broke. Because these rocks were not hard,
yes,
they bent.
Yeah.
And so we think that's happening at the end of the flood. The water drains away, some of the material is eroded, but further erosion actually makes the Grand Canyon and cuts some of these layers away and cuts through the canyon. This dark line right here is actually the profile of Grand Canyon.
Okay.
And so Grand Canyon's eroded and the Carbon Canyon's eroded, so we can actually
see
the fold.
Those folds. So this is what, before Grand Canyon, this is what it looked like.
That's right. Even with some more layers on top of that.
Solid layers with even more layers on top laid down by the flood.
Right.
And then all those catastrophic things we were talking about post-flood
mm-hmm.
then began to come into play.
That's right.
And all of this then gets removed, whether that's from the lake spillage or other things and so forth. And so then we're left with what we see today.
That's right.
And so are these the folds we're looking at right yeah. in here?
This is a big picture fold. So if you stand at the south rim of Grand Canyon and look miles and miles off into the distance, this is what you see.
Okay.
If you actually go on the river and climb up Carbon Canyon, you see smaller folds within the bigger mm-hmm. fold. So when you're actually at Carbon Canyon, you can't even see the monocline.
Yes.
But you can see the smaller folds within the monocline. Mm-hmm.
So then this brings us to this critical piece that you and Andrew are working on, and that is how do we know whether those folds occurred when they were soft or whether they occurred as a result of what the standard conventional
right.
Theory would posit.
So again, this Tapetes from a standard conventional view, was made a bit more than 500 million years ago. That's half a billion years. The faulting and the bending that takes place here in a conventional time scale is about 50 million years ago. So there's almost a half a billion years that separates those two events. And so the question that Andrew is looking at here is, how in the world could we have a monocline if there was really that much time between those two events? Mm-hmm. Instead, we would posit that since these events are very close together in a flood time frame, that it would make sense that the bending would take place. And so for years, we've just seen the bending there, but now we've been able to go collect rock samples. And Andrew is looking at those rock samples under the microscope. So we're gonna see what the story is there and see if it supports our hypothesis of the flood.